We're going to start in the book of the letter of Titus, Paul wrote to Titus. There's only three chapters, and by golly, we're going to have those done in 3 weeks. Last night, I did a wedding for a young couple that actually come up north, their parents are down here, the wedding was interesting. It turned out really nice. The young man was marrying this girl, Armando. That's a nice name, huh? It's not as easy for us English guys to speak that sometimes, but he was, he's 35, first time he's ever been married, and then the young lady was, she's about 31, and she's been married previously. Her husband was killed in an automobile accident, and she has been really badly damaged. She's still recovering. It's been about 5 years. It was kind of cool. Her father-in-law and mother-in-law from his first marriage, they were there. They came from Detroit to be part of the wedding. It's kind of really an interesting family. But and I just learned the day before that my friend Lori had passed away. She was a year older than me. And when you come from a small town like we do, you kind of like everybody is kind of like family, and many of you grew up that way as well. Lori and Stan were very good friends of mine for years and years, as long as I've known. And she passed away. And at the wedding, there was a lot of young people there, not people that we see a lot in villages, and two or three, a couple of them at least were pregnant, quite pregnant. There was a little set of twin girls wandering around. And so in the midst of all the things that are going on, I got home and I heard Kathy's brother had passed away, and just other things that happened all week. And so to see the young kids running around knowing that there's still another group coming was really nice. It's kind of refreshing, really. And I began to do the service, and Armando and Sarah were there, and I said, no, here's, repeat after me, I, Armando, take me, Sarah. And I thought he was going to pass out, I'm sure, and the tears just were flowing. And one of the problems is I get somewhat emotional sometimes too, but when the person that you're getting married starts crying and you're the officiator, it's not easy to keep not crying and keep your voice strong. So I said, take a deep breath. And he finally said to Sarah, I'm just so excited. I'm just so excited to marry you. I thought, isn't that great? It's such a joyful thing. So, sometimes we go through life day by day, and we have people that are struggling with things, and people are having difficulties, and then we're able to be part of it. People, we see young children coming, and then we see young people getting married with great love, and so it really was an exciting week. And so, in the midst of all the things that go on in our lives, is the song, I'll Fly Away Someday. Yeah. But in the midst of that, we live our life out. And I think this is the great thing about being followers of Christ, is that we see in the midst of tragedy, we can see joy. In the midst of struggle, we can see joy. It may not be joyous at the moment, but out of that comes joy. And so we see great things that God does for us. We just need to be sensitive to what God's doing in our lives and pay attention. So I just want to preface that because we see Mother's Day coming up next week. Men, don't forget that. I was a little bit but also we have other activities that are coming. We have the end of the month is Memorial Day, when we think about the memories that we have, the memorials that we have for those that have gone before us. What a tremendous privilege that is to follow them. So Paul's writing this letter to Titus. Paul, this is the third of what would be called the prison epistles, 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus. He's writing this letter. In the probable order, I'm going to just give you some idea what happened. It was some of the things. Paul was released from his first house arrest in Rome. He'd been that. He probably was in that time. And we've talked about that. You can read Acts. You can find that. Probably because his accusers did not choose to press charges. They didn't choose to show up. They stranded off. I was charged once with. I was accused of a particular thing, and I showed up, but the person that accused me didn't. So that's just when This is kind of what happened to Paul. He'd been in prison, but the accusers didn't come to do it. So, and then we see that he was just lost by default. Paul is free. Then Paul visited Ephesus. He left Timothy there to supervise the churches and went on to Macedonia. That's northern Greece. And then the third thing is he wrote 2 Timothy from there, probably. He visited Crete, left Titus there to supervise those churches, and went on to Nicopolis and Achaia. He visited Crete, left Titus there again, either from Macedonia or Nicopolis. He wrote this letter to encourage Titus. And when he writes Timothy, he writes Titus, he's writing to encourage. He visits Troas, where he was suddenly arrested, taken to Rome, imprisoned, and finally beheaded. This letter was written fairly soon after that he was arrested. It may have been from Alexander. We talked about him before, this coppersmith. And he said, God, do whatever you want to with him. It won't bother me either way. It's kind of the idea. But, and so he probably wrote that letter to Titus there. Titus was a Gentile. He was converted through the ministry of Paul. And so he would have been there to do the ministry. And he was probably one of the men that delivered 2 Corinthians to the Corinthians to help get them straightened out. Paul left Titus in Crete to use his administrative gifts to consolidate the work there. Artemas of Tarchus probably relieved Titus in Crete so he could join Paul as a captain. So Paul, he joined back up from where Paul sent him to Dalmatia, that's Yugoslavia, in 2 Timothy 4:10. Tradition says he returned to Crete and died there. So Titus was someone that had come under the conviction of the Lord through Paul's ministry. He was a Gentile, and one who had gone out that he had led to the Lord. And he had trained him up, and he became part of the ministry. The important topics discussed in this letter were qualifications for elder, instructions to various age groups, and relationships to government, and the relationship of regeneration to human works and the Spirit. So Paul writes a short letter, a letter of encouragement, a letter of instruction, and a letter sometimes in our world today we probably kind of skip over it. I don't know. We may not have really ever looked at it much, but it's an important letter. He talks about organization, teaching and preaching, and good works, kind of an outline of what he's going to talk about. And so we see that the opening greetings in chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, a bondservant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God, and the knowledge of the truth, which is in accordance to godliness, and the hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised long ago. So Paul opens up, again, this whole idea of Paul, who he is. He always starts with what he is. First thing he is a bondservant of God, a love slave of God. He always brings us to the point that it's about what he's done through Christ to serve God. It's not about Paul, it's about God. And a bond slave, that's the idea of the Greek name, a doulos, a love slave, who is serving. He's serving God. He sat down when God set him free and broke the chains. He fell at his feet and began to worship and said, I'll serve you. And so this is the idea. This is who Paul was. And he says that he's an apostle of Jesus Christ. He's not an apostle Paul, the apostle Paul. He is the apostle Paul, but he's an apostle of Jesus. And so this is an important thing. It's an important thing. He always brings out in his letters that it's about God and it's about Jesus and ultimately about the Holy Spirit. And I think as believers, we need to be able to integrate that into our lives to understand that we are about the business of serving God through Christ and the Holy Spirit. It's not about us. It's not about us. Not an easy thing for us to put aside us because we like we a lot. We like I a lot. We like me a lot. We don't really want to submit to the power of God. So he says, for the faith of those chosen of God and the knowledge of the truth, which is according to godliness. And again, the truth teaches us to become people that are like Christ or godly. And this is the whole idea in the hope of eternal life. We're serving Christ because of the hope that we have in him for eternal life. I'll fly away some glad morning, which God, who cannot lie, promised long ago. God cannot lie. He's one who is always promised. He always keeps his promises. He cannot lie. I want to just mention Lori for a second because I've known them a long time. I said earlier, but their obituary is out now. And I wondered what they would do because their relationships, Lori was part of the church, but Stan was never good. They're just doing a deep grief and no service. It's just no service. It's really, it grieves my heart because there is, it's just the fact that they just have not moved from one side to the other, from evil to good. And they live, they're good people, they're good folks, all that stuff, but they're still not people that know Christ as Savior. And it's grievous to me that they wouldn't have a service to honor God in the midst of that. So that's one of the things sometimes we kind of miss out people, miss out on really the freedom that we have. And even though we pass away, the freedom that we have to gather together and rejoice in God's great love. So the hope of eternal life really was not part of their life. And my wife and I both ministered to them trying to get that through, but we presented them a God who cannot lie and who loved them greatly and that they rejected. So it's grievous to my heart. But, verse 3, but at the proper time manifested even his word in the proclamation, which I was entrusted according to the commandment of God, our Savior, against him. Paul said, I was entrusted this word because he contacted me. And he says, writes to Titus, my true child in the common faith, grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. One of the things that we need to understand as a 21st century Christians and also just because we're Americans, that the church is an organism. It's not an organization. One of the great things that we mess up as believers is we want to be the part of an organization that has this. And that's not what the church is. The church is an organism. It's alive. It's changing, it's moving, it's doing things. And so we need to be people that realize that in the midst of our life, it may not be just exactly the way that we would ordinarily lay it down. We are not a business. We're not a business. We are an organism that is alive and that's changing and morphing and still focused on Jesus Christ as Savior. So we need to understand that. Sometimes we want to have it's all just these the way it has to be. That doesn't mean that we don't have organization within the organism, because we have an organism here that's alive as well, which is organized. But it's organized to operate and to function properly. Okay. And then in verse 5 it says, for this reason I left you in Crete, that you might set in order what remains and appoint elders in every city as I directed you. So he says that I want you to organize this organism. I want you to put it together because it's all dysfunctional. When our organism is dysfunctional, the cancer cells show up, stuff like that, it has to be adjusted, it has to be taken care of, keep it in order. If we get it out of order, it doesn't function properly. But we're still an organism. And so this is the idea. So he's left them there. Well, apparently Titus said the gift of organizing things, getting things going. And he says, here's the qualifications. Namely, if any man be above reproach, the husband of one wife, having children who believe, not accused of dissipation or rebellion, for the overseer must be above reproach, as God's steward, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not addicted to wine, not pugnacious, not fond of sore gain, but hospitable, loving what is good, sensible, just, devout, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word, which is in accordance with the teaching, that he may be able to both exhort in sound doctrine and to refute those who contradict. So here's the thing. We see this as that to be a man above reproach, and to be a man of one wife. And the commentaries, they don't agree on that, because is it one wife right now, or is it one wife only? So that's it. The big thing is you can't have two or three wives and, at the same time. So this is the idea. They have children, having children who believe, so there's a responsibility for us to raise our children up. Now, not accused of dissipation or rebellion. I looked up the word dissipation because that's an old word. Some of you guys got a new trend, one of the new living hen.
Wild.
Wild, okay, thanks. Accused of wildness. That's wild living, spending your money. That's what I looked it up on Google. I thought I knew what it meant, but then I'm thinking, well, maybe I don't. So, for the overseer must be above reproach as God's steward, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not addicted to wine, not pugnacious, that's not fond of sword and gain. Not fond of sword gain. So in other words, we need to live a life that represents and reflects Christ into our world. We don't do that without being inhabited by the Holy Spirit. We live a life like that because we've met Christ and He has given us the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God. He's given us the Spirit to enable us to live our life out as men and women that live above reproach, God's steward, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not addicted to one, not patient, not fond of sword gain. So we have a helper. We have the helper. And then he says, but we're to be hospitable to those who are leaders, loving what is good, sensible, just, devout, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word, which is in accordance with me, with the teaching, that he may be able to both exhort in sound doctrine and to refute those who contradict. One of the other problems that was going on in early church and early organization, we've talked about this in just about every book, part of the problem is the false teachers that were coming in, and he says you need to be able to contradict those that are false teachers. You need to be able to refute them and reprove them. So it's part of that opportunity, the responsibility we have as believers is to know what the Word says. And that really becomes a challenge for many of us because we want to just take it by osmosis, keep it alongside the head, or we put it on the coffee table, and we sort of put osmosis it into our brain. But we got to really look, pick it up and put, we got to let God speak to us about it.
It's close to
us. It's real close, yeah. But yeah, you want to get it up here. And then the offenders in the church, verse 10, for there are many rebellious men, empty talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision. So there was many people that were coming into the church, the circumcision of the Jewish people, that would be the Jewish tradition, who must be silenced because they are upsetting whole families. They are teaching things that should not teach for the sake of sword gain. They are teaching things because they want to get rich. That's the reason the sword gain is really the idea. That they want to make money off of the fact of doing, of the people that they teach to, the people that they don't lead to, is they want to make money. And so really, this is really one of the challenges that we have. One of themselves, a prophet of their own, said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, and lazy gluttons. They took a group of people, the Cretans, and they said, they're always this. To be a Cretan was to be a liar, was to be an evil beast, and to be a lazy glutton. That was the nickname that they were given. This testimony is true for this cause. Reprove them severely that they may be sound in faith. They need to be people, we need to be people that are sound in faith. Sound in what we understand to be the scriptures say. Not paying attention to Jewish myths and commandments of men who turn away from the truth. So the Cretans, if you were a Cretan, you were a liar and a cheat. And so the idea is that you don't follow those teachings of the Cretans is the idea. They make because they turn you away from the truth. One of the situations that we have as believers is we need to understand what the truth is. And that becomes a situation unless we study, unless we let the Holy Spirit guide us, unless we let Him deal with our hearts, then we don't really understand what's evil, what's wrong. And so we need to be people that that focus on the Word of God. And to be pure, all things are pure. But to those who are defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. For both their mind and their conscience are defiled. If we're pure, we live out the pure life, that's a wonderful thing. But if we are defiled, if we have defile teaching affects our whole life. Verse 16, they profess to know God, but their deeds, they deny, by their deeds they deny him, being detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. Basically, verse 16, this first thing, this first chapter is about false teachers to beware. Know what you're doing. I have a friend, when he was a young kid and I was doing the youth, he was about 14 years old, and everywhere I went, he was always right here. And he grew up, and he's a big tall guy now. He was doing the youth. He was teaching the youth. He wanted to teach them about purity. And so here's what he did. He went out in the yard, and his yard, his family had dogs, and he collected what the dogs leave in the yard. And he took it inside, he and his mother, and they baked brownies. One pan of brownies was very pure. The other pan of brownies he and his mother made was not so pure. It was full of stuff. You know what that is.
All natural.
So David took the two pans to the youth group and he said, I want to talk to you about living a pure life. And he said, I got two sets of brownies here, and I'm going to offer you to have, I'm going to offer you to have your choice of the pure or unpure. And he said, but before you make the decision, let me just show you this video. Well, he had been collecting the dog stuff. He had his brother and his mother video the whole thing. And when they videoed how they made the brownies and all that sort of thing. And he said to them, I'm going to show you this video, and then you choose the pure or the unpure. You're going to be surprised that all the kids chose the pure. And the point of the story, the point of things was that you can't just put a little bit of stuff, a little bit of bad stuff, a little bit of deceitful stuff here, not affect the whole mess. It's like a three-egg omelet. An apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God and the knowledge of the truth, which is according to godliness. We want to be people that consider ourselves, and we are called of God, empowered by Christ, and inhabited by the Holy Spirit, so that we can be men and women that impact the world with the holiness of God. What a great challenge. Well, what a great responsibility. But it's what God's calling you and I to do. To live in holiness so that he's glorified. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity we have to gather and share and just to be encouraged by your word. We thank you for the illustration from Paul and Titus about how we see how you work through them, imperfect people, Father, being molded into being a leader and the example for others to follow. So help each one of us to be faithful to you, to be men and women that are feast on the pure word of God. And we thank you and honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. We celebrate communion on the first Sunday of the month. You don't have to be a member of this church if you want to profess Christ as Savior. We do communion by the tincture. We'll break the bread and come up. Serve you the bread, you dip the bread into the cup, and take it, and then go back to your seat. So, Jesus got up at the Last Supper, and he said, took the bread, and he said, this bread represents my body, which is broken for you. He said, take and eat, and do this in remembrance of me. And he said, I want you to remember, every time you do this, remember what I have done for you. And what he's done for you, he's done for me, is he went to the cross. He hung on the cross. He died. He was laid in the tomb, but on the third day, he arose. And he ascended to heaven. And we anticipate that any time that God will send his son back to the earth. And so we want to remember the price that he was willing to pay for a sinner such as I. And as we enjoy that freedom and his salvation, we also want to remember that we've been called to go into all the world and make disciples. Then he took the cup and said, "The cup represents my blood, which is shed for you, for the remission of sin." And it's the same thing, we do this, we remind that it's the blood. It's the blood that has the power to wash away the sin. Some places they like to take the blood out of because it's too brutal, but in the scripture it talks about Christ's blood is the power to give to take away our sin. It's also the power of life. If you cut your finger, you'll see what the power of life is. It's blood. And it's the blood of Christ that empowers us, regenerates us, and causes us to be men and women and be followers of Him.